The National Party has been criticised for releasing results from, or for not releasing results from its independent investigation into allegations against Sam Uffindell the day of the Queen's funeral. The Tauranga MP is now cleared to return to caucus, but questions are being asked about why the report isn't being made public. National Party leader Christopher Luxon joins us from our Wellington studio. As always, grateful for your time this morning. Thank you for being with us. You received the report last Thursday. Why did you choose to release it on Monday?
Oh, look, I mean, we've been waiting for this report for some time. It's probably come a bit later than I wanted it to come. We received the report late on Thursday, digested it over the weekend with Party President Sylvia Wood, and then came and announced it as quickly as we possibly could. I think if I'd sat on it for any longer, I was being asked each and every day, where's the report, what's happening? And it was important for everybody involved that we got clarity and we announced where we got to.
Well, it's been suggested that it was A, disrespectful and B, cynical to release that report on the day of the Queen's funeral. Were you hoping that people wouldn't see it, that it would be hidden in amongst what was going on?
No, not at all. And I saw those comments from Grant Robertson, and frankly, it's a bit rich, Grant Robertson lecturing us in the National Party about something like that. What I'd say to you is, I made that commitment up front, which was that we would bring that report as quickly as we possibly could so that everyone had clarity, and that's what we were doing. At the end of the day, you know, we had an independent investigation. Sam was actually cleared, and we were able to move forward and reinstate him into our caucus. There's nothing disrespectful about that. It's actually fronting up and delivering and doing what I said. I'd be criticised, frankly, by you, because you would have come and asked me today, why haven't you released the report? It's sitting on the report if I hadn't done so. So, look, I don't buy that at all. You know, we got the report late Thursday night, digested it over the weekend and came forward very quickly.
Speaking about that report, though, why haven't you released it?
Well, look, it's very simple. I mean, we intended, you know, when the new allegations arose, I wanted to be reassured that there was nothing else there beyond even the time at university. We commissioned an independent investigation. The criteria for doing that and for people to want to come forward was, and to make their contributions, was that it needed to be private and confidential so they could do that in a safe space. We involved Maria Jew, who's the leading expert in this space, independent, impartial and expert in this area. And then we've faithfully recommended her, presented her findings through our statement. So I think we've done a really good job protecting and encouraging people to come forward, but equally being clear.
Well, it's very interesting because this morning Radio New Zealand is reporting that the original complainant and her father are happy for the full report to be made public, as long as there are obviously different things that are redacted. So I come back to the original question, and why hasn't the report been made public, or at least an executive summary?
Yeah, so Sylvia Wood has discussed the findings with those two complainants, but just remember there's 14 other people that have been interviewed, there's many others that have given written submissions, and they've done so on the basis of confidentiality given the sensitivities and personal stuff involved. What has come out of the report is there are differing accounts of the event over 20 years ago in Otago, but Sam has been cleared of that alleged serious behaviour. The most important thing for me is that no one else came forward with serious allegations of Sam that has caused them harm with his behaviour subsequent to King's College and this interaction with the flatmate. So that, on that basis, that's the reason why he's been reinstated to caucus and as an MP.
Wouldn't releasing the report make your life easier, though? Won't questions linger around why you haven't?
Well, it may well make my life easier, but it's about being values-led and what I made a commitment to people so they could come forward in a really, good process and actually feel safe doing so, was that we would respect their confidentiality. I've involved Maria Jew, the best person I could find in the country to lead an independent investigation, and then I faithfully recommended the findings in my statements, which we ran past Maria to say, is that capturing and reflecting those findings? And the findings are pretty clear. The alleged serious behaviour from Sam, didn't occur in the way that it was represented. And the second piece is that, Sam, there's no one who came forward saying that Sam had caused them harm subsequent to all those events. And on that basis, he deserves a second chance, and he deserves a chance to be able to get on with his career and demonstrate he's a person of good character and a good MP.
You mentioned the Casey Maria Jew a couple of times during this interview. She is bound by the terms of reference, though, which you set for her to investigate. Will you release at least the terms of reference?
Yeah, as we said in our statements, it's pretty clear there were two objectives here. One was to make sure, to get to the bottom of what, you know, conclude where events were from over 20 years ago. There were differing accounts, and we've got clarity around that from Maria. The second piece is to make sure that there was nothing further beyond the King's College incident or this interaction with the flatmate that caused harm to others. And, you know, that's what we've discovered through this.
Were those the terms of reference that were given to Maria Jew?
Yeah, well, that's exactly what those objectives of what the report was all about.
Were they the terms of reference? Not the objectives. Were those the terms of reference that were given to KC Maria Jew to investigate?
Yes, those are the two objectives that that Maria Jew had to work through, and that's what we've got from this report. So, look, I appreciate that people want it to be they want us to release the report or do whatever. The reality is, right from day one, I've made it really clear we're not doing that because we need to be able to make it safe so that people can come in and share confidential information that's deeply sensitive, and know that otherwise we wouldn't have had people participating in the way that we did. And in fairness for Maria to be able to do her job and do a great job doing it, that was important.
I guess the question here is, where is the transparency? How can the public have complete confidence in your decision to reinstate Sam Uffindell if they haven't seen the report, or at least the terms, or a summary, an executive summary, or at least the terms of reference?
Well, essentially, Jenny May, through my formal statements that we made on Monday, those statements have been run past Maria Jew. But you have to understand there are sensitivities involved in an investigation like this. And we made a commitment to people to say, come forward, please come forward. We want to hear it all on all sides. And as a result, to do that, you have to be able to make it a safe process for people to do so. Those statements that I gave were run past Maria to say, are they a faithful representation of the key findings of the report? And they are. And so, that's what I've tried to do. I mean, and people may disagree, but the reality is I moved really quickly when I heard these serious new allegations. I put an independent process in place with the best person I could find in the country to do so. And we've come out to say that, look, the serious allegations, the serious behaviour that was alleged, and also subsequent to King's College and this interaction with the flatmate, Sam is a different person. And that was confirmed in our own reference checking, and now you've seen that confirmed through this investigation. On that basis, he's back as an MP for the National Party.
Do you have full confidence in Sam?
Yes, I do. And here's the deal, Jenny May. Everyone deserves a second chance and forgiveness. He was upfront about the King's College incident. Yes, we should have made it available to the public, into the public domain through the campaign. But beyond that, he has genuinely demonstrated that he is a different person. And I have to say to you, go through Parliament, there'd be very few people in Parliament with perfect pass, and we'd have very few people in there if that was the case. And so what I'm interested in is, if someone admits that they've caused harm and understand the negative impacts of their behaviour on their victims, and if they have genuinely demonstrated they have changed, they've turned their life around and they're a different person, then we owe it to them to give them a second chance to do that.
Yeah, talking about second chances and forgiveness, is that somewhat hypocritical given that you've consistently called this government out for not being tougher on crime?
Well, I do believe that. I think the government's got the balance all wrong on crime. I think we're not actually using enough appropriate consequences for serious repeat offenders, and equally we're not being victim-centred enough with this government. And that's a different issue. That's how I feel very strongly. The government has got the balance all wrong on crime.
Can we talk about New Zealand and the conversation around becoming a republic? New Zealand Republic released a report yesterday saying that it's time to discuss the future of the monarchy here in Aotearoa. Is it time?
I don't think it is. I don't see any need to change our constitutional arrangements, and I don't think the New Zealand public do either. I'm in two or three towns each and every week. I've had thousands of people come and talk to me. I have not had a single person raise our constitutional arrangements in the last 9 months with me, and I think we are a long way off from that. There has to be a groundswell of support for the conversation to take place. There frankly isn't in the country at the moment.
Just finally, before we wrap things up, I'm really interested to get your thoughts on a story that our deputy political editor, Mikey Sherman, broke last week around those on the inside being denied face-to-face visits. How do you feel about that, about those on the inside, as I say, being denied access to their families over the last couple of years? Does that concern you?
Look, I mean, those are obviously operational matters for corrections, but I would think that they should be entitled to what they're entitled to see their families. And so I'm not sure, I don't have enough background, I'm not aware of this story, to be honest, Jenny May. I need to look into it for you to give you a more considered response, but, you know, that's obviously a matter for corrections, but, you know, we would expect people to be able to see their families from time to time as per the rules that they're under.
Christopher Luxon, leader of the National Party. As always, like I say, thank you so much for joining us this morning, as you do every Wednesday.
Thanks so much.